Welcome to the next lecture in the second module. What we have seen so far is the need of a general setting. We looked at an example of constant propagation and we realized that the mold of bit vector data flow frameworks is not sufficient to describe constant propagation. And then we realized that we need to talk about data flow values. We need to talk about the operations on data flow values, solutions that we get, and algorithms that we use to get the solutions. In the previous lecture, we looked at the concept of lattices. We saw that we can use partially ordered sets to represent data flow values. So these partially ordered sets are the sets in which each subset has a GLB and a lub defined, and these are called lattices. We saw that a partial order is a relation which is reflexive, antisymmetric, and transitive. We also saw that on a lattice we can define a meet and a join operation, and we are interested in the meet operation. And we observe that the meet operation is commutative, associative, and idempotent. That was the mathematical part of it. Now we want to relate these concepts to the data flow values, the way they are used in data flow analysis, and want to use the mathematical basis to talk about the soundness of the information computed by data flow analysis. We will not talk about the soundness of solutions. We will talk about whether a certain data flow value represents the information that is supposed to represent soundly or not. So we begin by introducing the concept of conservative approximation. A value x, a quantity x, approximates another quantity y conservatively if and only if x can be used in place of y without causing any problems. The validity of these approximations is context specific, which means that x may be approximated by y in one context and by z in another context. Let's take some simple examples. Let's say we want to approximate money and you want to talk about your income. Let's say from some source you have earned rupees 1050, but when you're talking about your income, it's safe to approximate it to 1000, because then you know that you have earned, when you think that you earned less, then you will perhaps plan to spend less. So income can be downgraded safely, whereas when you want to make a budget, when you want to talk about possible expenses, in that case, if your potential expected expenses is 1050, you can safely approximate it to 1100. So these are two different situations in which the same quantity 1050 can be approximated by 1000 in case of income and by 1100 in case of expenses. Here's another example. We want to approximate time. Let's say your estimated travel time to reach a certain place is 2 hours. You can safely approximate it by 3 hours. If you have fixed a time, you want to meet someone, it's better to make sure that you are going to need more time than you actually think you're going to need. By contrast, if you are preparing for examinations and you have 3 available days, it's better to assume that you have less time than that. So when you travel, it's better to assume that you're going to need more time. And when you're going to study, it's safer to assume that you have less time. We use this sense of approximation in data flow analysis also. How? We will see that in great details as in this lecture as we go forward. Two important requirements of discovered data flow information are that the information should be sound and the information should be precise. By sound, we mean computed information should cover all runtime behaviors, and we will explain that. We do not want to miss out on any runtime behavior. It should be precise in the sense that information that does not correspond to any runtime behavior should be minimized. Recall that data flow analysis is something that builds an approximation of runtime behaviors. So we would law we want to ensure that all runtime behaviors are covered, and we want to ensure that we have not covered any spurious behaviors that do not occur at runtime. And here the intended use of data flow information, which is the context, determines the validity of approximation of data flow information. So we have seen this example before. We will look at the how the context determines, gives us different conclusions by looking at examples of available expressions analysis and live variables analysis. Recall that we had said before that let us look at the soundness and precision of available expressions analysis, and let us see when it is sound and when it is precise, and we'll contrast this with that of live variables analysis. So here is an example that we have seen before. Let's say you have expression B star C is available, but we mark expression A star B also to be available, which means that an occurrence of A star B may be eliminated. So we have this A star B, and if we wrongly mark A star B to be available, we will eliminate it by some temporary that corresponds to A star B. This should perhaps be some other temporary T prime. This is a harmful error. This is a harmful error because A star B has not been computed, so its value is not available. So this solution is unsound. What that means is when we include an extra expression which is not available into the set of expressions that are available, this spurious inclusion is a harmful error leading to unsoundness. By contrast, here we have expression A star B is available, and we say our set of available expression is empty set, which means that we have spurious exclusion of an expression which we know is otherwise available. What would happen in that case? In that case, an occurrence of A star B, for example, this occurrence may not be eliminated. This is an error, but this is a harmless error. The solution is sound because nothing would go wrong, but it may be imprecise because we have missed out an opportunity of common sub-expression elimination. From this example, we generalize that given sets A2, which is a superset of A1 representing availability information, using A1 in place of A2 is sound, assuming that A2 was sound. Using A2 in place of A1 may not be sound, assuming A1 is sound. Meaning a smaller set is sound and a larger set may not be sound. We want to compute the largest possible set of available expressions, and therefore we begin with the universal set as the initial conservative value. By contrast, in case of live variables analysis, we observe that spurious inclusion of a non-live variable, this is a harmless error. We might say apart from y, x is also live. Actually, x is not live. This is a harmless error because we will not be able to do dead code elimination. So this is perfectly fine. This is a harmless error. Solution is sound, but it may be imprecise. On the other hand, if we have expression variables x and y both as live, but we miss out on the liveness of x and mark only y as live, so this is a spurious exclusion of a live variable. Okay, this is a useful assignment. In this case, x is equal to z plus 10 is a useful assignment because the value of x is printed, but because we have excluded x, it may be eliminated. This assignment may be eliminated. This is a harmful error. The solution in this case is unsound. Thus, we conclude that given L1 superset L2, using L2 in place of L1 is sound, provided L1 was sound. However, using L1 in place of L2 may not necessarily be sound, assuming L2 is sound. We want to compute the smallest set of all live variables, which we know is the most precise information. And since liveness sets grow and we want to compute the smallest set, we choose empty set as the initial conservative value. And note that when we say initial conservative value, this is not the boundary information, this is a conservative value at each node. So we summarize our findings in the last two slides as follows. Recall that soundness requires avoiding harmful errors and precision requires minimizing harmless errors. We have looked at some examples of harmless and harmful errors in the very first lecture in the motivation slides for this course. So for available expressions analysis, erroneous inclusion of an expression, marking an expression as available when it is not, that's an erroneous inclusion. This error is a harmful error. By contrast, erroneous exclusion, missing out on an expression which is actually available, is a harmless error. The situation is exactly opposite in live variables analysis. Erroneous exclusion in this case is a harmful error, whereas erroneous inclusion is a harmless error. Declaring a variable to be live when it is not live is fine, it is harmless, it's not going to cause soundness problems. The most precise solution in available expressions analysis is the largest set satisfying the criteria. In case of live variables analysis, it is the smallest set satisfying the criteria. And therefore, in case of available expressions analysis, initialization, which is different from boundary information, is a universal set. Whereas in case of live variables analysis, initialization is empty set. And the confluence in case of available expressions analysis is set intersection. And in case of live variables analysis, it is set union. Note that although we are basing the criteria of harmless and harmful errors on the choice of applications, and this might seem a bit ad hoc, there is a more formal basis that coincides with this choice. As we shall see later in this lecture, including spurious runtime behaviors corresponds to harmless errors, whereas missing genuine runtime behaviors corresponds to harmful errors. We formalize this intuition in the next few slides. So let's once again look at harmful errors and harmless errors. If there is some uncertainty, we have to make some approximation. Our information may be erroneous, but in which situation it is harmful and in which situation it is harmless, in which situation it is sound, in which situation it is imprecise, we want to take a look at it once again from a slightly different viewpoint. So let's say we're talking about live variables analysis and we're talking about static property at a program point N. This is what our data flow analysis has discovered. So our data flow analysis might say a variable to be live, yes, or it might say that a variable is not live. This is a static approximation. At runtime, however, we know that if that a variable may be live along all paths reaching at that program point, so we're talking about static property at program point N, and we're talking about possible dynamic behaviors at program point N. So at runtime, the variable may be available along all paths. It may be a variable may be live along all paths, or variable may be live along some path but not along other paths, or variable may not be live along all paths. We can talk about a similar situation for available expressions analysis, where we mark an expression to be available or we say an expression is not available. This is our static approximation. However, at runtime, the variable may be available along every path, or the variable may be available along some path but not along other paths, or the variable may not be available along all paths. Which means that at runtime we have three possibilities, whereas at compile time and static time we are representing these three possibilities only by two possibilities. clearly there is some approximation happening. Clearly, we have some possibility that we conclude at compile time. We have some possibility which is approximate, which is imprecise. In case of live variables analysis, we say mark a variable to be live if it is live along all paths. However, if it is live along some path but not along other path, we still mark it as live, which means that this compile time yes actually includes yes and uncertain in the sense that yes along some path and no along some other path. On the other hand, when we are absolutely certain that variable is not live along any path, it's only at that point that we say that variable is not live. So this no is a definite piece of information in case of live variables analysis, and this information is conservative. This is conservative because it also includes the possibility that the variable may not be live along some other path. This is an example of a spurious inclusion of a live variable. There may be no along some path, but we still mark it as yes. And as we have seen before, spurious inclusion is harmless. There is no problem with spurious inclusion in case of live variables analysis. What happens in case of available expressions analysis? In case of available expressions analysis, the situation is exactly opposite. In case of available expressions analysis, we say an expression is available only when it is available along every path. When the expression is available along some path but not available along some other path, we combine it with not available along any path and we say the expression is not available. So in this case, marking an expression to be available is a definite property, whereas marking an expression to be not available is a conservative property. Note that this is a spurious exclusion because the expression may be available along some path, but we are still saying no, it is not available. Therefore, we are excluding it from the set. This is an exclusion. And this is spurious, this is erroneous, but this is conservative. This is a harmless error. It does not cause any unsound.